Morning, everyone. Bonjour à tous. Je suis heureux d'être ici aujourd'hui avec le vice-première ministre Freeland, la ministre Anand, ainsi que la docteure Tam et le docteur New. Alors qu'on lutte contre cette troisième vague, notre priorité absolue continue d'être la sécurité de tous. Hier, on a tenu notre 30e rencontre des premiers ministres des provinces et des territoires depuis le début de la pandémie. Mon message pour les premiers ministres a été clair. Le gouvernement fédéral est là pour vous appuyer. Yesterday, the premiers and I had another productive meeting. We talked about vaccines, testing, and what we can do to beat this third wave. We also talked at length about borders. Premier Ford asked that we suspend the arrival of international students. Because at this time, Ontario is the only province requesting this, we're happy to work more narrowly with them. We'll be reaching out to their officials today to formalize that request. Again, I want to be clear. This is not the time to travel. On land borders, as a reminder, anyone who comes to the U.S. land border has already been tested in the U.S. in the last 3 days. Then they have to get tested again. And everyone has to quarantine for 2 weeks and do another test on day 8. We're enforcing very severe consequences for anyone breaking these rules. Yesterday, in addition to all this, Deputy Prime Minister Freeland provided an update on the budget as well. I also took the opportunity to congratulate Premier Silver of Yukon on his re-election. I look forward to continuing to work with him on everything from the fight against climate change and creating affordable childcare to our commitment on building a stronger relationship with Indigenous peoples. In fact, I'll be calling Sandy later today so we can discuss these priorities further. As I told everyone around the table last night, it's vital that we keep working together. We're following the situation with this third wave closely, especially in places that are hardest hit. Yesterday, Alberta reported their highest single-day total since the beginning of the pandemic. Premier Kenney announced new restrictions to slow the spread of the virus, and our government is ready to work with the province to provide support. For Ontario, medical teams from the Canadian Armed Forces began arriving in Toronto on Tuesday night, including critical care nurses who will work in the ICUs. This first deployment of 55 members of the forces will be providing assistance to Sunnybrook Hospital and its mobile units. On Tuesday as well, a healthcare team from Newfoundland and Labrador arrived in Ontario. They're helping at Toronto General Hospital. Like I said before, we are actively working with the Government of Ontario to determine how else we can support them. For Nova Scotia, where cases are also high, we've deployed 60 Canadian Armed Forces members to testing centres to help stop the spread of the virus. And for New Brunswick, we've approved the province's request for assistance for long-term care homes. The Red Cross will assist in up to 3 facilities until the end of June. Nunavut has also requested additional support to deal with their current outbreaks. We're moving quickly to keep people safe by sending more PPE and health equipment and by providing support for households in isolation who need food or mental health services. We're also engaging with other provinces that are hit hard by this third wave to see how we can help. We're ready to send any resources needed to protect you and your family. And of course, we're continuing to deliver PPE, rapid tests, and vaccines. So far, we've distributed more than 15 million doses of vaccines right across the country. Wednesday, almost 1 million doses arrived in Canada, including our first shipment of the single-dose Janssen vaccine. Starting next week, we will be receiving 2 million doses a week just from Pfizer alone. This will mark another major ramp-up. We will continue to work with provinces and territories to get these doses to Canadians as quickly as possible. Il y a de plus en plus de gens vaccinés. Dans plusieurs provinces, la vaccination sera ouverte à la population générale très bientôt. C'est une nouvelle encourageante. Au cours de la dernière année, on a souvent répété que chaque effort compte. Chaque effort aide à protéger nos travailleurs de la santé, nos familles, nos voisins et tous les Canadiens. En portant un masque, en gardant nos distances, en restant à la maison, on aide à sauver des vies. Et c'est vrai aussi de se faire vacciner. Chaque dose de vaccin compte. Aussitôt que c'est votre tour, je vous encourage à prendre un rendez-vous pour recevoir votre vaccin. C'est important pour se protéger soi-même et pour protéger les autres. Et c'est seulement en se faisant vacciner qu'on va pouvoir passer à travers cette pandémie et revenir un peu à la vie qu'on avait avant. Au début de cette crise, on a promis aux familles, aux travailleurs et aux petites entreprises que notre gouvernement va être là pour eux. On met tout en place pour que notre relance économique soit la plus robuste et rapide possible. Just a few minutes ago, Finance Minister Freeland introduced the Budget Implementation Act in the House of Commons. This is the next step forward on the plan we laid out in last week's budget, a plan to get through the pandemic, create jobs, and make sure our economy comes roaring back. This bill includes extensions of support programs that have been a lifeline for millions of Canadians, from the wage subsidy and the rent subsidy to the Canada Recovery Benefit and the Recovery Caregiving Benefit. We're facing a very serious third wave, so we need to make sure we can deliver support to the workers and businesses who rely on these programs. Of course, that's not all this plan lays out. With this legislation, we're also setting the foundation for strong economic growth, with funding for early learning and childcare, support for students, a $15 federal minimum wage, and much more. I'll let the Finance Minister go into more detail in a moment, but here's the bottom line. These measures will help you get through what is hopefully the last stretch of this pandemic. This is about how we set ourselves up for a stronger, faster recovery that includes everyone. So all parties need to work together to get this support through the House of Commons to Canadians as soon as possible. En terminant, tel qu'annoncé ce matin, je tiens à souligner qu'Isabelle Hudon, actuellement ambassadrice du Canada en France, a accepté de devenir la prochaine PDG de la Banque des entrepreneurs du Canada, soit la BDC. Sa feuille de route dans le milieu des affaires, autant au Canada qu'à l'international, fait d'elle la personne idéale pour ce rôle. Elle sera la première femme à la tête de la BDC et pourra poursuivre leur travail essentiel pour la relance économique afin d'aider la croissance de nos PME. Dans son rôle actuel, l'ambassadrice Hudon a su mener de nombreuses initiatives de diplomatie économique et, entre 2017 et 2020, les échanges commerciaux entre le Canada et la France ont connu une hausse de 30 %. Our fight against COVID is not over yet, but there's reason to hope. With more people getting their shot and more vaccines on the way, we will get through this. And as we do, we're going to keep working together to rebuild a safer, healthier Canada and a stronger, more resilient economy that leaves no one behind. Before I pass it over to Deputy Prime Minister Freeland, I want to extend my deepest condolences to the families, friends, and victims of the tragedy at Mount Meron. Canada stands with the people of Israel and the Jewish community.